Hi everyone, and thank you for listening to my presentation. Here I'm going to talk about research that is from my PhD dissertation that I did at the Université Lyon 2 in France and Université du Québec à Montréal in Canada. A research that was partly funded by the Fondation pour la mémoire de la Shoah in Paris, and that I'm now to some extent continuing in the University of Manchester, and especially the Humanitarian and Conflict Response Institute, by working more broadly on displaced childhood. The case study that is at the center of my talk is the War Orphans Project. 1,115 Jewish orphans, I'm going to explain later on the quotation mark, or like Jewish young people who migrated to Canada from 1947 to 1952, most of them being teenage boys from Eastern Europe. I'll say a little bit more about that later on as well. The project was sponsored by the Canadian Jewish Congress, which was at the time the main organization of the Canadian Jewish community. The aims of my research throughout my PhD was first to retrace the young people's trajectories, individual trajectories, a bit before but predominantly during and immediately after the war, looking at the discourses and practices of the various actors that were involved at local, national and international level. And finally, also addressing the place of the War Orphans Project in Canada's national narrative and collective memory. The material at the center of this research is a source that I think particularly fascinating, the Canadian visa application files of each of the 1,115 accepted candidates, but also about 200-250 rejected files that are all kept at the Canadian Jewish Archives in Montreal. So these visa application files are about a 2 to 6 pages form filled during an interview with the young candidate by a caseworkers predominantly coming from the International Refugee Organization, the Joint, and other key actors, especially Jewish organizations that were involved in refugee resettlement at the time. These case files are particularly useful, as I say, to retrace the individual trajectories of the young survivors during and immediately after the war, especially through what you can see here, a timeline of their location from 1939 to the moment of their interview for a Canadian visa. The case files allowed me to kind of map where the these 1,115 Jewish survivors were at the beginning of the war. So you can see predominantly in Poland, Romania, Hungary, and Czechoslovakia. And then at the end of the war, unsurprisingly, most of them were in the German American zone of occupation, but also a little bit throughout Europe, even in countries like, for instance, Sweden. The case files are also very interesting because they are useful to examine how the caseworkers wrote about the young survivors. So in other words, they allowed me to observe the observer, to use the words of Ludivine Pantini and Jean-Claude Vimont, especially through the two sections that you can see here, the personality of the child and the child's attitude about going to Canada. The War Orphans Project was authorized by the Canadian government in April 1947, at a time when Canada still had a very selective immigration policy in terms of health, wealth, and ethnicity that clearly disfavored Jewish population. This was, for instance, present in a very well-known work by Irving Abela and Harold Trooper, None Is Too Many. During the negotiations with the Canadian Jewish Congress, the federal government set up a very strict eligibility requirements for all candidates to resettlement in Canada, because the young people had to fit established nationality quota. They had to be able to demonstrate that they had lost both of their parents and that they were under 18. And finally, they had to be in a satisfactory health. These guidelines that of course reflect how children, especially orphaned, were considered at the time as ideal immigrants whose assimilation would be easier. These guidelines were strictly enforced by Canadian gatekeepers, and a lot of applications end up being rejected on the ground of being over 18 or having one or two parents still alive. In this presentation, I want to discuss the selection process through the case files because it helps us better understand how power structures define categories such as childhood or orphanhood to decide who is and who is not an ideal immigrant, but also how young people themselves sometimes manage to take over these categories. And this last point in particular, I think, resonates with a broader question that is common for all historians, but also in particular for historians of children and young people: who exactly speaks in the archive, and in that case, who exactly speaks in the case files, in the administrative records I had access to. During the negotiation with the Canadian Jewish Congress, as I said already, the Canadian authorities provided very clear-cut definitions of who was a child and who was an orphan. A child was considered as an individual under 18, like most legal frameworks, national and international law today, and an orphan was defined as a child who was lost both of their parents. So the Canadian Jewish Congress and partner organization frequently tried to push to extend the age limit to 21 and also to include half orphans in the project, so maternal or paternal orphan, to echo the terminology used today by UNICEF. But the Canadian authorities constantly refused to do so, and in the end, only individuals under 18 with no parents were eligible for a visa, and applications of older individuals or individuals with one parent still alive were systematically rejected by Canadian gatekeepers. These very strict guidelines first meant that the Canadian Jewish Congress and the various organizations that work with them had to clearly establish the identity of the applicant, which was of course a particularly difficult task in the aftermath of the war, verifying their names, their nationality, and also their birth date and orphanhood by looking for existing administrative records, for instance a birth certificate, or gathering testimonies from family, friends, from neighbors, and so on. Everything basically to prove that, yeah, the candidate was under 18 and had lost both of his parents. It also meant building or trying to build ideal candidates by editing and reformulating their narratives to match stereotype figures of course, real children, insisting on notions of innocence or vulnerability, ideal migrants, using the vocabulary of self-sufficiency or determination, and finally of deserving refugees who had been victims of persecution but who could still be rescued. In order to do so, to match the expectation of the Canadian government who wanted ideal immigrants and the expectation of prospective foster families in Canada that wanted vulnerable and innocent children. To give you A concrete example. Here you can see one caseworker description called so personal impressions about Yvette, a young Slovakian girl that who survived Ravensbrück and was living in Bratislava at the time of interview, so in around 1948, 1949. She's described as a lovely child, very polite, well-bred, bright, and healthy. She's also skilled enough to assimilate quickly and contribute immediately to the Canadian society, as she was already speaking English fluently, had ambition, but not too much, as she said that she was ready to learn anything that will make her useful and self-supporting. And you can find throughout the more than 1,000 case files available a lot of very similar examples, so of this figure of the innocent and deserving child, but also the ideal immigrant and the ideal future citizen. This, I think, once again reflects the efforts of intermediaries, so case workers, to present candidates in ways that will match the expectations of Canadian authorities. It might also reflect how young people themselves develop strategies in their interactions with power structures and their intermediaries. And I want to finish on this element that I think is probably the most interesting one, the fact that for young people, categories such as childhood or orphanhood, so legal categories of childhood and orphanhood, are keys in the ways they either try to benefit or distance themselves from the control of authorities. Sorry, I'm of course drawing on Edwin Goffman's notion of presentation of self, but also the work of many other scholars that have examined how individuals are often pressured to perform identities to fit the expectation of state administrations and other power structures, especially to gain access to certain social rights. I'm thinking here, of course, of the work of Didier Fassin that has examined as how state administrations and their intermediaries objectify the experience of vulnerable population, whether it be asylum seekers or welfare beneficiaries, sorry. And Fassin has also very interestingly highlight the what he calls adaptation, sorry, mechanism individual developed, and the negotiation games they played with administrations and their intermediaries. In the case I'm discussing here, that kind of negotiation games or adaptation mechanism meant first, changing their name, changing their birth date, their nationality, especially lying about their age, in a way to qualify for a visa, hiding the existence of their parents, or even in a few cases, stealing another applicant's identity. I was able most of the time to grab such cases in later correspondence when the Canadian Jewish Congress uncovered the situation, or even in recent testimonies in which the survivor themselves admitted having lied in their application. Here you can see example of Bella, for instance, where which a caseworker of the Canadian Jewish Congress said that the boy fibbed about his birth year in order to qualify under the project. And another one, Robert, it was not only not until several months after his arrival in Canada that he told his caseworker that he had a mother and a sister that were still alive in Europe and therefore wouldn't have been able to qualify for a Canadian visa. So this is one layer and one example of these self-presentation strategies, full-on misrepresenting their age or the situation of their parents. But I think there's also another layer in which young survivors develop more complex self-presentation strategies to fit with figures of ideal immigrants and deserving children. one-on-one interviews with caseworkers or immigration agents gave them the possibility to adapt their answers based on the reaction that they generated. And it's very likely that I think many of them acted in ways they perceive will make them look worthy of being welcome and being accepted within the resettlement project. It meant, for instance, acting childlike and vulnerable, or, and sometimes at the same time, also insisting on their skills and ability to become quickly self-sufficient. So in other words, young people managed to adapt themselves to childhood as a legal category, strictly defined by chronological age boundaries, so by lying about their age, for instance, but they also adapted themselves to the way adults and administration, more specifically, perceive childhood by acting, again, childlike, based on their understanding of the perceptions of adults. So, if we go back to the description of Yvette that I showed you earlier, who exactly speaks here? I think this example perfectly embodies how challenging it is to answer such question, especially when you have this so-called direct quote within the text. When the young girl, after having stated that she wanted to become a doctor, immediately added that she was ready to learn anything that would make her self-sufficient, one must wonder, was it suggested or later edited by the caseworker that was filling the form, or was it Yvette herself that adapted herself and was hoping to fit what she thought was an ideal candidate for a resettlement in Canada? So to conclude very briefly, so despite the difficulties and limits of the archive that I will be happy to further discuss with you in June, I think this case study illustrates how administration defined categories such as childhood and orphanhood to include or exclude, but also how young people, often with the help of adults, of intermediaries, manage to adapt the way they spoke about themselves, how they present themselves to administration and their intermediaries, and therefore manage to take over that kind of categories.